Hello, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Mormons. We're here to bring you the best in Mormon news and commentary, as we've been doing for, what, four wonderful years now, Al? Is that what we're...
The hard-hitting issues, Jeff. That's what we do.
It's very serious.
The hard-hitting ones.
Very, very serious. So I'm delighted to be here this week. It's a wonderful week. It's almost Christmas. Who could ask for anything more?
Jews. Jews could.
Because Hanukkah was so early this year.
They got the shaft.
Anyway, before we banter our heads off, we're joined by a wonderful guest this week. Yes, everyone, we've done it. Guests. Russell Stevenson is here, known as the Mormon History Guy. Hi, Russell.
Good to be here.
So many of you might have heard Russell. I don't know how long you've officially been around as the Mormon History Guy, but you've definitely been doing the rounds for the past few months within the Mormon, the blogosphere and podcasts and the like.
Yeah, you know, I do have the curse/blessing of being a little bit too long-winded for my own good. I have something of a love affair with my own voice, so
you'll fit right in.
I look for any opportunity to say anything at any time, anywhere. It doesn't really matter what. So
wait, you haven't really made it in the blogging world until you've been on with Jana Reese. Have you done anything with Jana Reese?
You know, I'm familiar with her work, and I have not had the blessing to speak with her yet. So
we are a communal nobody.
When did we decide that Jana Reese is our zenith?
She is. I think McKay Coppins actually.
McKay Coppins
that.
Is it. Until you've
no,
been...
McKay Coppins is a big deal.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Oh, he's huge. Oh, yeah. We've been there since the beginning, man. We are basically responsible for McKay's career.
I kind of feel bad. Where did he got in on Newsweek? But before that, was he like the Daily Universe or something?
No, well, he worked.
He was on Mormon Times for a little while.
We first found
cut
him
his teeth on the old Mormon Times. The how much sour cream should go in your general conference casserole?
Like you said, the heady questions of the day.
That's right. Dude,
Utah Mormon culture is at the same time in some ways reprehensible, but also just admirable and awesome. It's such a great, just it's a little island. I love it. I'm not from there.
It's here. It is here.
That's true.
Absolutely.
Al is living there. I asked Al today if he was in Utah, and he said, I think so. He wasn't sure.
I've had a long week, man. I've had a really long week. I've been in a couple different states, not sure what's going on right now. And this inversion is ridiculous here.
I read that it's at like an all-time worst mark right now, isn't it? Isn't it just really, really bad?
Yeah, it's Al-Qaeda that's doing it, and they're doing a great job.
It's the terrorists?
Absolutely.
I thought it was El Nino, but I think no. I'm behind the times on that one. So
No, the Pakistani version of El Nino.
Okay.
The
Pakistan, so... I'm trying to think if I know anything in Pashto, but I don't. So I'm not gonna.
No, so flying in, we ended up circling last night. We were circling for about an hour and a half, just waiting for the fog to move.
Ugh. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, 24 hours on that, it'll get you sick.
Because if they mess up there, your plane's going to crash in the Great Salt Lake and sink in 5 feet of water. So, you know,
It could have got real, real
or
fast.
Or you could have had a, now I'm blanking on his name, that Hudson River landing from a couple years ago. You could have had that.
I remember that. That would have been epic. Why didn't you prepare yourself for that?
I was ready. My head was between my knees. I had the oxygen mask on me first before any children were saved. I did everything I was supposed to.
It's like that Seinfeld episode where George pushes all the women and children out of the way.
there's a fire.
The best one.
Oh, yeah. No, I was out the door. I was ready. On the wing.
I have to say, Russell, you're much sassier in this sort of forum than you seem to be when I heard you on, you know, Radio West and your podcast. When you come off as the consummate professional, I mean, you're
it's an act, as you can see. It's all an act.
No, all right,
Russell, that's a compliment from Jeff. Do not be offended by his compliments.
My compliments are usually pretty grating in one way or another. But it's a good thing. I mean, it was fun. You know, I've heard your stuff, and I said, "Oh, this will be great, no matter what." But then he comes on here; he's already got this sass, this bravura about it.
Yeah, we were prepared for Bookworm Steve.
No. You know, Ezra Taft Benson. I'm going to paraphrase Ezra Taft Benson. He said, "I wouldn't give a nickel for someone who doesn't offend anybody." So, words of a prophet. Words of a prophet.
Now, was that Prophet Ezra Taft Benson, or was that Thorn?
It was Apostle.
It
Ezra
was
Taft
Thorn
Benson.
In everybody's side. 1960s Ezra Taft Benson.
Yeah, it was more like 1960s. Ezra
Secretary
Taft Benson,
so. Of Agriculture.
Yeah, and /John Birch sympathizer.
Yeah.
So.
Man, some of his books are actually surprisingly entertaining.
Well, I mean, that man, we could go off on this forever because I, Russell, you've probably read this book. Have you read the Rise of Modern Mormonism and with David O. McKay?
Oh, yeah. Greg Prince's book is excellent.
It's an excellent book. Al, you should totally read it. And you read that, and it's incredibly eye-opening. I mean, Elder Benson back then was just quite the firebrand. He had a lot of interesting things to say, like how the civil rights movement was just a communist front, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, and that was in General Conference. It wasn't just in some kind of...
No, was it really?
It was. October 1967.
No!
Yeah.
That's crazy.
And you see, that I actually have something of a personal connection to this strain of Mormon thought. I had the opportunity to teach for a private school in Utah County. It will go nameless, but the school is founded on the ideas of Cleon Skousen. And if you know anything about Cleon Skousen thought and Ezra Taft Benson's thoughts, I mean, they're two peas in a pod. So, you know, they were founded with the hope of... One, ushering in the second coming, and two, restoring the Constitution.
Yeah. And
so most of the time was spent in raging against the Obama administration, talking about how the Book of Mormon specifically prophesies about Obama, how the 14th Amendment is the worst, you know, the worst development in constitutional history, things like that. So maybe we'll touch on this again. I don't know. But
did they have a baby and name him Glenn Beck?
They easily could have.
No, his middle name is going to be Blaze.
I'm going to name my son Blaze.
It's actually funny you bring that up because one of the things we saw this week, one of the stories is that up over in Mill Creek, which is Mill Creek's what kind of southeast Salt Lake, right? There's basically something they might as well call the Joseph Smith Party, but it's just the Independent American Party. I don't know, Russell, you've probably heard of this. I think it goes back.
Oh. Yeah, this is actually, this is really interesting and troubling in a number of ways. And it actually connects strangely.
You had me interesting and troubling.
Yeah,
go on.
It actually has a weird connection to Elijah Abels, who was the first black priesthood holder, too. So several decades ago, there was a man by the name of Caleb Shreve. He was a prominent individual in Ogden, a war veteran. He had been a professor of military science. And he was absolutely committed to revealing the civil rights movement for what it was, a communist plot. And he also didn't want any of this talk about Elijah having held the priesthood. He insisted that that the priesthood had been stripped from him in the early 1840s. And the reason this is relevant is, you know, in his papers, you also see a montage of newspaper clippings. And, you know, it's kind of conspiratorial, and it's a kind of, you know, he takes one newspaper clipping and connects it to another newspaper clipping.
Right.
And one of these clippings is talking about George Wallace, who was a presidential candidate in the 1968 presidential campaign. And his founding principle was racial segregation. I mean, that is what made
the man
relevant.
What a platform to run on. That's...
I know, and interestingly, he mobilized a lot of people. And you see Caleb Shreve talk about how George Wallace was actually the fulfillment of Joseph Smith's vision and, you know, his prophecy. And and there was a party that was associated with Wallace that was called the Independent American Party. So this is why this development about the Joseph Smith Party is rather troubling. The fact that George Wallace called his party the Independent American Party.
So this is a definite nod to something before.
So now it's basically trying to make a comeback, and so a bunch of flyers were distributed, probably using the ward list, no doubt, to members of the Mill Creek Second Ward, and apparently they were having a quote unquote like Constitution class at the church building, which I think was just a recruiting front, and it's been shut down because you can't go having that political stuff in our buildings.
Shut her down.
You can't do that unless it is a bill in California to defeat gay marriage, in which case you can use the meeting house
for
whatever you want, basically. Just
So this is actually interesting because there's a lot of rhetoric in the history of the church around this, right? The white horse prophecy, the Constitution hanging by a thread, the elders will save the Constitution. This is something that we as a people are kind of built to expect to happen in the last days, right? I mean, we're supposed to be gearing up for this. The only trouble that I have with that is anytime I've ever heard anybody reference any of those, I've immediately thought this man's a crazy.
Right. And why, like, why? I want to know, like, why is it that we're so committed to this vision? I mean, and it's interesting because, you know, you look at the different ways in which this particular prophecy has been applied. And, I mean, let's make sure that we're clear. The White Horse prophecy and the Constitution hanging by a thread prophecy, they're actually two different things based on different historical documents. So I'm specific.
Wait, go on, go on. What? How are they?
So the Constitution hanging by a thread prophecy, that's from a documented discourse that Joseph Smith gave in, I think it was 1842, 1843. And the White Horse prophecy was a recollection of what the Latter-day Saints thought that Joseph Smith has said. And this is where, you know, supposedly the prophet or, you know, a leading member of the church is going to come in riding on a white horse and he's going to save America from himself.
I see.
So the White Horse prophecy, that's not very well documented. The Constitution hanging by a thread prophecy is well documented. And, you know, you look at the way the ways this has been applied, right? Even during the Watergate scandal, you had liberal and progressive Latter-day Saints like Eugene England saying that, well, we see that the Constitution is hanging by a thread because of what Richard Nixon is doing. Right. So it's one of these things where it just depends on your politics. You know, if you happen to be, lean right, well, then obviously anytime there's a liberal in office, you say, well, the Constitution is hanging by a thread.
Right.
But if you're, you know,
Obama is the devil.
Exactly. Yeah, indeed. Or, you know, it's funny when I was teaching at this school.
Yeah, BYU.
My students. Right. Yes. No, this was the private school.
I know. I was.
This is. Oh, okay.
I was trying to get you. I was trying to get you to out it.
Oh, no. BYU, I've actually taught at BYU. BYU's great. I have nothing but good things to say about BYU. But this school, they were absolutely convinced that if Obama was not the Antichrist, he was taking his cues after that model. You know, they would just go on and on and on. I once listened to a guy lecture us for 10 hours.
Oh, geez. Like,
literally 10 hours, and most of it was a diatribe about, you know, the impending apocalypse that all of us would face.
Wait, was it really a guy lecturing, or was it just Glenn Beck's TV station?
You know, it would have been awesome if it were Glenn Beck's. Because Glenn Beck is actually amusing, if nothing else.
Yeah, I think
he's a great entertainer, man. I mean, that guy entertains.
10 hours worth of that, though? If they switched General Conference to, you know, that, just 10 hours of that, it could be more engaging.
Well, here's what's crazy. Break it up. This isn't. I'm actually surprised because this isn't an unusual thing, right? This thought process that Obama is the Antichrist sort of. It's not a popular thought, but it's one that I've run into a couple of times, mainly from the older Mormon folk who've been waiting patiently for this. For a lot of these prophecies that we're talking about to sort of come to pass, right? For the government to be hanging by a thread, and they're saying, aha!
Yeah,
here it is. We've got
it. I feel like some of these prophecies are almost like the Mormon version of the rapture. Like, people actually sit there anxiously awaiting for them to come to pass and looking for reasons.
Well, my question around this is, like, how do we kind of swallow a lot of these prophecies and say, all right, I mean, what is our role in it? Are we even supposed to do anything with this stuff? I mean, we know that we'll help save the government. Does that just mean, like, can't we just be happy with running for office and trying to enact change?
Yeah, I mean, that's the real question, is how actionable are these prophecies? Like, what do they mean to us as a Mormon community? And, you know, John Taylor, and this is, you know, back in the 1870s, 1880s, when, you know, Apocalypse Now was even more of a watchword, right? You know, you have the Supreme Court ruling that polygamy is not a good thing, and that, you know, it is legal to outlaw it. So you have all these Mormons who are really scared about their future, and even John Taylor would say, you know what, it's okay to go ahead and plant a tree. Even if we think the apocalypse is tomorrow, plant a dang tree. So,
but John Taylor is our only foreigner president of the church, so there's something to be said for that.
Oh, well, we can't even trust him. Never mind. Sorry, I take it back.
He's a Canadian, people. Like, what do we have to do with that?
Of course he'd want you to plant a tree, that guy.
Because that's what Canadians do. They ask you to plant trees.
If and when President Uchtdorf were to somehow assume the mantle, which would be far-fetched maybe because there's a lot of people in between him. Yeah, just look out, people. It's going to get all Euro-style on everybody pretty quickly. Especially, does it seem to anybody else? We talked about the Christmas devotional last week on the show. I don't know if you caught it, Russell, but
yes,
does it seem to anyone else that President Monson is perhaps ailing a bit?
I mean, it looks like he's struggling. It's not the first time, though. I mean, Spencer W. Kimball, his voice was incredibly impaired. In fact, he wasn't even able to read some of his talks. That's how bad it was. So it wouldn't surprise me if he were, and it wouldn't trouble me if he were.
I feel like we're kind of an unfair view of President Monson, though, because we've known him as a 50 to 60 year old, I feel like, forever. For so long, yeah. Right? He's been just this young, spry, full of energy guy. And now, I mean, he's, what is he, 85?
I think 80? He's 87 or 88 now.
But, like, I mean, that's pretty darn old. And so we expect him to just be this, you know, young on his feet, wiggle your ears every time we see him type of guy. And I you know, he's just. He's just aging.
Same thing's happening to him as happens to, you know, has happened to a lot of the prophets. And you look at the standard that President Hinckley set, right? Yeah. I mean, you know, those are huge shoes to fill where he's continent hopping all the way into his 90s.
That's got to be unfair to everybody because not only into his 90s, but President Hinckley basically ran the show from, I mean, you know, through much of the years of President Benson's administration and most of the Hunter at time. And President Hinckley was basically the number one, either de facto or later de jure, for a very, very long time. And so we were very accustomed to him, yeah, like just kind of sprightly doing his thing. And to see somebody like President Monson, who's been in the 12 since, what, the McKay era, I think, right? Was it President McKay who called him? To see him slowing down potentially is different, I think, for a lot of us, absolutely. But I've just seen some things going around the interwebs, take them with a grain of salt.
Well, no, he's legitimately old. Yeah. I don't think you need the internet to tell you
this. Well, no, but I'm saying there are some people who say have sources and things like that he's actually suffering from dementia and early onset Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
I've heard the same thing.
So I don't know if that's true or not. But it makes me wonder if the whole format change that we had this year for the first presidency Christmas devotional, I agree it might have been to open up, but it could have also been potentially to not put too much pressure on President Monson to deliver a long address, and this was a nice excuse to shake things up and make it work in a different way. I don't know. This is all speculation, of course. But
Sure, but it would make sense, and like I said earlier, it really wouldn't trouble me as it is apparently troubling some people.
Yeah. Well,
I think it troubles some people because if President Monson were to pass away before President Packer, that means we have President Packer. And I know many people.
Oh, no, the Dark Knight. we cannot have. No, actually, Dark Knight's probably too kind in their eyes. The Dark Prince.
Yeah. he who must not be named.
Well, this is something that's been interesting that I've kind of been mulling on. So, I know we're going to get there. Maybe we can go there right now.
Whatever.
But the blacks in the priesthood. You know, thing that came out last week, right?
Right.
Which I love. I love sort of this kind of test in transparency that the church is doing, where they're just saying, "All right, well, let's try throwing some of this stuff out there. We're going to actually have conversations about this and see if that helps, rather than just pretending it doesn't exist." So I'm really, really enjoying that. We had Blacks of the Priesthood last week, polygamy this week.
Right.
I mean, we can take guesses as to what it'll be next week, guys. But But last week was the blacks and the priesthood, and the one thing that came out of that that was interesting for me was I feel like the church acknowledged that Brigham Young may have made a mistake, right?
Right.
And where they said, all right, well, the intention was this, and we know that from the outset. I mean, Joseph Smith was sort of an advocate for rights for slaves and things like that, which is why there was a lot of trouble. I mean, I believe that was like the instigator for the press being destroyed, was that he was printing anti-slavery propaganda rather than just religious propaganda, right? And so there's some things around that like the stage was set for blacks in the priesthood to like sort of be fine, and then Brigham Young came in and said, no, this isn't right. We need to change this, right? Am I paraphrasing this okay?
It's somewhat more complicated than the narrative you've told, if only
you
because
you are wrong, sir.
No, that's a very elegant way of saying you're wrong.
You see, one thing that people don't seem to, a lot of people don't recognize, and by a lot I mean a lot, is that as late as March of 1847, Brigham Young was absolutely committed to blacks holding the priesthood. He supported blacks holding the priesthood.
What?
Yes.
So
and,
why?
You know, Grant.
Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, what I was going to say, why? So you said March of 1847. That seems like, would that be, that's like in transit across the plains, wouldn't it be? Like, what happened
no, at that,
right
at
around
that point,
then?
They had settled in winter quarters in the fall of 1846, and they were still there in March of 1847. And, you know, the inciting incident for this was that there was a man by the name of William McCary. He was a biracial musician / con man. He married a white Latter-day Saint girl, which was incredibly taboo. I mean, it was the kind of thing that could get a black man killed in 1840s.
You've described
America.
Seal and Heidi.
Right, but he came into the Winter Quarters community, married her outright, and Brigham Young looked both of them in the faces and said, it doesn't matter what skin color you have, we are all the same blood. And, in fact, one of my favorite elders in the church is a black man living in Lowell, Massachusetts, cited in specifics. And this was in the face of significant criticism from the Latter-day Saint community. A couple weeks later, he leaves, goes out west as a whole, this is a place thing. And while he's out west, William McCary actually implements a kind of interracial polygamy. Which, I mean, you've already crossed one line by marrying a white girl, and now you're marrying a bunch of them secretly?
This sounds like a Tyler Perry movie. This is blowing
yeah.
up. I secretly married 12 white girls. A Tyler Perry joint.
So, William McCary and his wife are chased out of the Winter Quarters community.
And his first wife, right?
Yes. Like the other okay. wives, they were left behind. And whether they were actually wives or not, we don't really know. Probably was, given the context. But for all we know, it could have just been, serial sexual trysts. But the important part of this is when Brigham Young comes back that fall, there had been a real shift in sentiment towards the black community. I mean, before there had been some level of tolerance, if only because Joseph Smith supported them so much. So, okay, this is how Joseph Smith wants to do it. Fine, yeah. He's the prophet. He knows best. But with Joseph Smith gone and Brigham Young gone, they were left to their own devices, their own prejudices. Brigham Young comes back and sees how much hatred there now was towards the black community that really didn't exist before, including amongst some of his leading associates. And this really marks the turning point in the discourse about the African-American community. You see Brigham Young saying these kinds of things interracial couples should be killed, things about, how we need to be really leery of the black community. And then by 1849, you're seeing him make the first connection between skin color and priesthood restriction. And by 1852, he's making these comments public.
So do you feel that...
Wow.
Do you feel that... was that change driven by pressure from just the body of saints, from the zeitgeist of the era? I mean, I know a lot of that's just conjecture, but what do you feel would have caused?
Was he amputating the leg to save the whole body?
Yeah,
right?
He's doing a bad face in that sense.
That's probably too kind to Brigham Young, to be honest. Brigham Young, he came from a world where blacks and whites just didn't even live anywhere nearby each other. I mean, he was in upstate, He was in New England, profoundly white, not a lot of blacks running around, and he just wasn't used to interacting with the black community. So what ends up happening is, once he is forced to engage with the black community, I mean, he does have Joseph Smith, who's informed
of
his
views. But he was fine in the beginning, right? Like at the first interactions you're describing.
Yeah, he was tolerant. He was willing to roll with it. I mean, he loved Joseph Smith. He trusted Joseph Smith with his own life. And if Elijah Abel's good enough for Joseph Smith, he's good enough for me.
Okay.
That was, the general sense that you get from Brigham Young. And that's why when he meets William McCary, it's like, well, William McCary is just like Elijah, so I have no reason to think that he's anything different. But then the second something happens, he's ready to distance himself from it entirely. And, of course, when you have something like a mob uprising happening in Winter Quarters, he just didn't feel like he had any good reason to support black inclusion anymore.
Which is interesting. And because I remember when I listened to the Radio West bit, and you kind of had a little bit of back and forth with John DeLand, and I'm almost losing my train of thought here. But so how much of it do we feel was a reflection of the times? Because that's always been a big argument about this. Is this
right.
just something that came from the Lord to either protect the saints from themselves, or was this really something that came from church leadership just kind of bowing to the will of the masses and just cruising along with it until the time made sense? Because, of course, you
right.
can look at when the priesthood was restored. Anyone could make the argument that it looked like it was a matter of convenience. I mean, you had the civil rights movement.
Yeah, expediency, right.
The civil rights movement happened in the States. They saw that they wanted to get into Africa. You had the church growing in Brazil, and you needed to have priesthood there amongst a very multi-ethnic society. So you could very easily make the argument that, hey, this is just a matter of efficacy, and it makes sense. Though at the same time, a lot of revelation is a matter of efficacy. I mean, that's why we ask about things and decide to change course, because we realize there might be a different course to pursue, and the Lord just approves it.
Sure.
So, I mean, and a lot of this, like we all say, is some can be speculation, but what do you think? Did you see a history of church leaders simply just sort of bowing to the pressure and the will of the people during that time?
Yeah, right. You know, in my comments on Radio West, as well as in some subsequent writings, I've made the comment that it was, you know, a matter of collaboration, right? I mean, you have the leaders, you know, they're obviously the stars in the drama. You know, they're the leads. But no lead can be a lead without an ensemble, right? It takes a village to exclude a child.
That is so true. I know this.
So, you know, you have, you know, Brigham Young, he's already tepid about black inclusion. And then you have the body of the saints. They're saying, what are you doing letting guys like William McCary into our community? And Brigham Young, he's not so committed to, you know, to black equality that he's willing to buy that.
Yeah, it's a quick fix, right?
Right. So, okay, all right, you know what? You're right. You're right. We don't know a lot about his exact shift in thinking in the summer of 1847, but we do know that William McCary had a real impact on him, as well as on the Latter-day Saints. So I'm not willing to say that, you know, church leaders are like, all right, if you say so.
Right.
But neither am I willing to say that it was entirely top down, that, you know, church leaders were saying, no, you're supposed to be racist. Now you're going to be racist. Yes, we'll be racist. Both caricatures are incorrect.
Is there anything that happened, you know, in the subsequent prophets that came directly after Brigham Young? Do we have any insight into why they didn't just say, all right, well, now that I'm here, we're going to fix this?
Right. You see, and this is interesting, because after Brigham Young died in 1877, you know, the issue came up again in pretty stark terms. Elijah Abels approached the first presidency in 1879 about receiving his temple endowment. He already had the priesthood. He never lost the priesthood. No one had tried to take the priesthood from him, at least according to the records that we have. But when he asked about the temple endowment, you know, President John Taylor, he was really hesitant about it, and he decided to explore the issue a little bit further, do some investigation, and he talked to two individuals who claimed that they had heard comments from Joseph Smith about the state of black people in the Mormon community. One of them was Zebedee Coltran, and in his comments he said, okay, so Joseph Smith asked me to administer some ritual ordinances to Elijah. I was so disgusted. I thought it was an awful experience. I didn't even want to touch him. But eventually, Joseph had a revelation of sorts and said, actually, no, we can't give black people the priesthood anymore. So with this knowledge, or I say knowledge in quotes, in hand, John Taylor comes back to Elijah and said, listen, we have every reason to believe that your priesthood is illegitimate. Joseph made a mistake. That's what it came down to. Joseph made a mistake.
On a sort of related note, I'd love to know what you guys, what everyone thinks about this. So what do we think? There's that stuff with restoration era things, but then what about Book of Mormon text? Some of which has been changed in recent years. You know, just the whole debate between fair and delightsome, dark and loathsome, all that sort of stuff. So it's one thing if the people, if there was a general mood within the church to sort of accommodate that, turn a blind eye to it, maybe address it later on. But then what else do we say about what we regard as ancient holy writ?
Right.
That came, you know, well predates the body of saints with any sort of those pressures.
Right.
What do we say to that?
Well, certainly. From my perspective, you know, first of all, you know, talking about the changes in the Book of Mormon more generally, I am not a fundamentalist when it comes to language. I do not believe, you know, that the Lord communicates to us in perfect, pristine, you know, grammar error free language.
Yeah, we've read Songs of Solomon. Yeah, we know it.
The fact
we all love Songs of Solomon, right? So we shouldn't expect that. But more specifically to this issue, if a person believes in the historicity of the Book of Mormon, that, you know, that the events in the Book of Mormon did essentially take place, one can still accept the race-based language in the Book of Mormon. And because what, you know, you look at the ancient world, right? Do you expect ancient peoples to be racially inclusive? They are profoundly tribalistic, far more tribalistic than we are today.
Yeah.
So them talking about Lamanites as being dark and loathsome and filthy, that's exactly what I would expect of an ancient tribe.
Well, the Nephites.
I would be surprised if the Nephites weren't racist. I mean, that's the times. I mean, it was worse then than it is now.
No, I think you could openly make the argument that, I mean, there was a sense of racism, like, among the Nephites. Of course, there was a sense of straight-up superiority. I mean, that's not unique to scriptures. It's not like you read the Old Testament and there isn't a sense of superiority from the Israelites over the Canaanites and the Amorites and all of them. So
certainly.
That is a common theme in scripture. But it is interesting because I just find it interesting that that's fine if that's what's there. But, of course, as we've amended the scriptures a little bit, we've tweaked some of that language.
Yes.
Well, because that's so hard. That's so hard to read in a modern day context, right? Especially when we're trying to be inclusionary and reach out to everyone. That's really hard language to have just sitting there. Yeah. And people read it today and say, "I'm sorry.
Excuse me. What was that?" Mm-hmm. You know, B.H. Roberts. You know, he was one of the first, you know, Mormon scholars to begin to suggest that, you know, perhaps an element of Joseph Smith's background and his personality and his language ended up affecting the language of the Book of Mormon. And, you know, my approach is that, you know, as we've received additional light and knowledge, you know, about, you know, the state of mankind and about how we should treat our, you know, our friends and neighbors who come from different ethnicities, that we realize, okay, maybe Joseph Smith's language wasn't as good as it could have been, right? He was constrained in some way by the times in which he lived.
Sure.
Well, that kind of flies in the face of a lot of the general thinking of just, you know, the fact that he went back and corrected language and, like, language that he wouldn't necessarily have even known. I mean, there's a large chunk of opinion that says that he, like, what is in the Book of Mormon is valuable directly because it's an exact or, like, direct translation versus what the Bible is, translation of a translation of a translation, right? So, I mean, I don't know. Personally, I feel like I would struggle with that understanding a little bit more than maybe the Nephites were screwy rather than Joseph Smith's translation was screwy.
Right.
But that's just my preference.
I mean, my preference as well is to accept that the Nephites were screwy. I mean, that's one that makes the most historical sense. And yes, I did just say that the Nephites were screwy. But then again,
excluding Nephi.
Excluding all of our favorites. The Nephites were screwy.
Well, so going back to my original question, I was trying to ask before I so butchered our my paraphrasing. The struggle that I think that this document highlights that the church put out is that we as a people have an understanding that the Lord will never let a prophet lead us astray. If he does, he'll kill him. Right?
more great paraphrasing from Al.
Right.
No, that is the doctrine. The Lord will never let a prophet lead us astray, right?
I would say, from my perspective, and based, you know, if you look at all the different comments on prophetic fallibility versus infallibility, I would say that is probably too stark of a characterization.
That doesn't sound like me at all.
Boyd K. Packer once said, human error does manifest itself on occasion, but never to the permanent detriment of the work. So, from his perspective, I mean, can the Mormon people end up, you know, going off of the path that, you know, the Lord laid out for them? According to that perspective, well, yes, they can, but not irredeemably so.
Well, that's actually really interesting because, you know, the people of the Lord are supposed to have their eye on the ball for the long game, right? Not the short game. The downside that I'm seeing to this, though, is that I think that there's going to be a tendency of people kind of piecemeal putting together their religion based on quotes from prophets and things that they like and skipping over the other ones saying, oh, well, you know,
was his own opinion.
Yeah.
As a single male, this whole no sex before marriage thing, that'll come around as soon as the guys really figure it out.
Well, it's,
maybe I should just venture out.
Yeah. It's and I love that you bring that up because last week we mentioned this a bit more and I described it as sort of cherry picking one's way through the gospel. And we got a little bit of flack from some people because they said, well, what's wrong with that? Don't we all do that? And I think to clarify, we all do it in a way in that we're all fallible. We all have different weaknesses. And of course, some things get greater emphasis than others on our great, you know, journey of discipleship and of trying to draw closer to the Lord. That's inevitable because we're human. But I do feel like what Al said. I mean, yeah, don't we run the risk of this slippery slope where people start picking?
There's a danger in putting an asterisk on everything that the prophet says,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. And then building on that, and I would love other people's input, especially, I mean, Russell, you're well learned in these things. The fact that we have I think it can be such a fuzzy line between what is a word from an apostolic witness and what is just like a word from, you know, Dave Bednar, for example, right. Especially when it comes to things like publications of Deseret Book, which is on a church label, but it's not official, right. Official word yeah. of the church, but it's an apostle writing a book, giving counsel to the saints.
Well, yeah,
and it's murky.
We flip flop on that a lot. We flip flop on that a lot because we go back. I mean, that's the catch all, right? Oh, Bruce R. McConkie wrote Mormon Doctrine not as an apostle. More is just Bruce and just writing that. That must be why there's some things that have been changed and on it goes.
And then we can be saying like, well, you know, this isn't divine counsel from the prophet. This is just this member of the 12. Just, you know, it's his musings.
I would think if I brought this up to Bruce R. McConkie, his response would be the Lord will continue to reveal and change and adjust doctrine. I mean, much like you said, Russell, around. You know, no permanent damage, right? The Lord has his own timetable, and if he knows that like we can circle back and correct some of the misunderstandings or mm-hmm. missteps of prophets, then he's got that luxury, right? And so,
mm-hmm. so,
God,
right?
Yeah, that's,
I agree. I mean, you know, speaking to your comments about okay, what's the difference between Elder Bednar versus Dave, right? I think this indicates that we haven't fully developed our doctrine of revelation. We haven't systematized it. And if you look in Islam, the Islamic scholars have developed a rather sophisticated way of determining, you know, the value of various statements. Obviously, the Quran, you know, is the most valuable of all. And then you have the Hadith, which is, you know, the sayings of the Prophet. And it's very clearly delineated which is to be held up, you know, to the highest, you know, as being the highest standard, and then which is perhaps, you know, less weighty, and then eventually get to the point where, you know, it's not very significant at all.
Yeah.
We have not developed that kind of model for understanding our prophet's words yet, and I look forward to the day when we have developed that.
Wait, do you really? I mean, like, that seems bizarre to me that, I mean, that's kind of the beauty of a modern-day prophet, of a living, breathing right. oracle of God, is that he can say something that's on the same level as a Book of Mormon doctrine or a Bible doctrine, right? That whole idea that has not ceased is really endearing to us because that's what the priesthood is supposed to be. That's why
right.
we have a prophet.
Right, but I can understand, though, how it's harder to delineate, though, you could say, you know, to really decide. It's really easy to rank it when you decide, you know, the scripture is the closed canon of God, so of course that trumps everything else, and then the rest is supplemental. But since we have things that can happen in tandem, I understand why it could be more confusing. It's much harder to sort of stratify.
Right, everything. Right. And plus, you know, if you look at a comment that Brigham Young made about black people, and I mean, it is so cringe-inducing. Right. I mean, are we going to point to that and say, well, see, he was giving the word of the Lord to the people of the saints at that time. I am absolutely convinced that, you know, that does not, those comments do not fit within the Mormon tradition. It doesn't fit with 2 Nephi 26:33. It doesn't fit with what Joseph Smith did and said. So, you know, I'm not about to say, well, you know, that was the word of the Lord to the Mormon people. You know, but to your point, obviously we need to have some kind of hope that prophets can give us new knowledge and new information. The question is, you know, what are the rules that we apply for determining, okay, this is, you know, the word of the Lord to us at this time versus, you know, this is an offhanded comment that Tom made when he was sitting, you know, in his backyard over the barbecue.
Yeah,
right. Well, because what I'm thinking of is like maybe, like, let's say Thomas S. Monson tomorrow came out and said, guess what, guys? Polygamy's back. Hoo-ah! And
I would not be crying hoo-ah. I'd be just crying. So, go on.
I mean, like, as members of the church, the charge to us is to go and do, right? I mean, like, we are allowed to go and pray to know that revelation was from God. We're allowed, like, we have some wiggle room and all of that, but really there's no room to say, nope, that's not a real revelation.
When we say go and pray for yourself, we tend to say it with the assumption that eventually you'll come around.
Right, that it is right.
Yeah, go pray for, you know, you need to find out for yourself, but we know what the answer will be.
You can do it your way, I'll do it the Lord's way.
There is something to be said that perhaps we have developed maybe almost a crutch with the prophetship, you could say. Like, we expect everything to be dictated to us in some ways, while not maybe putting forth the effort into praying and receiving revelation for ourselves and actually understanding that. I think it's easy to take a lot of those steps, but then just expect President Monson to come out and just explicitly outline everything else that's supposed to happen.
And, you know, Neil L. Anderson, as well as D. Todd Christofferson to some degree, you know, they've recently made comments about, you know, some of the rules that we should apply to these comments. They said that true doctrine, doctrine that you can really hang your hat on, is doctrine that is repeated over and over again in a number of different contexts in a number of different ways, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, I look at, you know, the blacks and the priesthood doctrine, right? Well, you know, you look at the kinds of things Brigham Young said about it. Well, okay, he was pretty consistent about his views on it. But after his death, you see the Latter-day Saint people, Latter-day Saint thinkers, they're beginning to shape-shift. They don't accept Brigham Young's rationale anymore, and they begin to accept another rationale. And then later on, they accept, you know, okay, well, we don't know why it came about. And I'm like, wait a minute, if this is true doctrine, it should be taught time and time again. And yet, it wasn't. The rationales kept shifting with the times.
Which, with that logic, I mean, we had a spell around evolution and our, you know, abhorrence of it. We had a spell. I mean, there's a lot of doctrines out there that we've come across that very strong statements have been made, which are really, really tough to discuss over the water cooler at work when somebody found the internet, right?
Right. Adam God theory. Right. Yeah, let's talk about that.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, you're just like, hold on, what? What do we believe? He said that, and so, I mean, that's actually, and much to Neil Anderson's credit, that man is incredibly comforting to people that are trying to pick their steps through today. A lot of today's kind of discourse around that. So, this has been a great, like, I've been wondering about this question all week, and so I appreciate that we've been able to go around it a little bit.
Now, what do we think about, just shifting a little bit, what do we think about the new plural marriage publication? We've talked a lot about the, you know, the race and the priesthood one from last week. I feel like the plural marriage one doesn't quite hit with as much of a splash as the one did last week.
It's very interesting still.
Yeah, what do we think of that? How do we feel about it? Do we feel like it does justice to our history with polygamy? Do we feel like we're still just trying to kind of sweep things under the rug? What are our impressions of the plural marriage and families?
Speak for us.
I will speak for you because I'm that pretentious. So, you know, based on my reading of it, you know, it obviously, you know, it doesn't go as in depth as many of us would like it to go, right?
What's missing from it?
Well, you know, I mean, it does address to some degree, you know, the negative experiences of plural wives in the Utah era, but it really doesn't capture the lived experience.
It doesn't touch Joseph Smith and polygamy.
Well, it doesn't, and in fairness, I mean, I happen to know that will be a separate article. So
okay.
Because there was no way you could put Joseph Smith's polygamy and, you know, Utah polygamy into one article. You couldn't do it justice.
Right.
Gotcha.
So that would be the one thing I would have liked to have seen more of, is this, you know, a discussion of, like, you know, the pain and suffering that some of these plural wives experience in the Utah.
Well, because they encapsulate, I mean, when they touch on that, they say, yeah, these women were free to leave these marriages if they were unhappy.
You know, divorce was pretty rampant in Utah. I will say that.
Was it really?
It was.
I don't know my Utah history very well because I've just avoided it.
It was so easy to get a divorce in Utah. Like, you didn't even need to be a Utah resident to get a divorce in Utah. You could be in Illinois and say, I plan on being a Utah resident, and that would get you a divorce. That was how freewheeling the divorce laws were. And one time, Brigham Young stood up before the congregation, and he says, all right, women, I'm so tired of hearing you complaining about your husbands. I grant you all a free divorce. Go. Do whatever you want. Just because, I mean, polygamy, it was such a difficult system to maintain and to sustain.
I'm imagining a seven brides for seven brothers sort of set where all the men suddenly jump up and grab their guns and scramble. No,
yeah.
Annie!
Yeah, well, that kind of situation happened to my ancestors, so I can definitely sympathize with that. If I could write it, I would make sure people understood that, you know, that this was a system that made life very hard on women. I mean, yeah, they were granted independence, but it was in an era where women weren't used to having that kind of independence. So, you know, you're basically throwing them to the wilderness and to the wolves, you know, without any kind of, you know, support.
Now, the long-time logic that it was needed for crossing the plains, these women needed husbands, they needed to be included in sort of the family circle or the camps of 10 families and that kind of thing. I didn't really see that touched on very much either. Is there any sort of one, like in the priesthood one, it was sort of Brigham Young did this, and that was a lot of the cause for it. Is there any, I guess, scapegoat in this article of like, here's why, and here's, you know, sort of why we left it and how that
works? Why we left polygamy behind are you talking about more about the manifesto?
Yeah.
Oh, right. You know, that they don't really touch on that as much as I would have liked them to either. And again, that is such an incredibly complex topic though, you know, because with polygamy, you know, you're dealing with racial issues. You're dealing with Americanization. You know, you're dealing with statehood. So, you know, if I were in charge of writing that kind of article, I would devote an article unto itself to, you know, the ending of polygamy between 1890 and 1904.
Oh.
Because it was, I descend from polygamous stock in the Mexican colonies. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for people sort of ignoring the manifesto in Mexico.
Jeff's a mudblood.
Yeah, I'm a mudblood.
Oh, the mudbloods. I see.
I am a mudblood. The funny thing, though, is I'm sure you all saw this week, though, of course, that there was a Utah law, you know, prohibiting polygamy, and a federal judge sort of smacked part of it down this past week, which is very interesting. And we were wondering how long it was going to be until these cards started falling down. Once you start sort of opening up the way for same-sex marriage, how long is it going to be until polygamists can say, well, my right to free speech and free exercise of religion are being compromised by federal law? And so now I don't understand every in and out of this law, but basically it said that there was a clause that talks about cohabitation, which in Utah means polygamy. And that was... It's not legal now, but it's basically just been decriminalized, is my understanding.
Right, and you see the whole idea—the idea of illegal cohabitation. I mean, it came about, you know, during the anti-polygamy laws of the late 19th century, and what the Mormons would do is, you know, they're kind of sneaky like this. They wouldn't ever carry out legal marriages. They would just seal people in the endowment house or in the temple or in other places. So what you end up seeing is you end up having these husbands with living with, or, you know, associating with many wives, in quotes, but according to the law, they weren't actually wives. So what the federal government did was they tried to frame the law in such a way that they could still get the Mormons even if they hadn't married their wives legally.
That's the cohabitation clause.
Yeah. Illegal cohabitation, exactly. Yeah. So, you know, we're not talking, you know, in their eyes, we're not talking about marriage license. We're not talking about, you know, officially, you know, going to City Hall or whatever. We're talking about living with more than one woman.
Yeah.
Even now, it's illegal to have a marriage license for more than one wife.
Right. So now it's just the simple cohabitation that is no longer a problem.
Right. Now you can live with as many women as you want to live with.
Because it makes sense. Because
I wish I could do college all over again.
But it makes sense because if the state doesn't have anything to do with it and it's just strictly religious and you're just saying, I consider myself married to these people, but the state doesn't care at all, then what do they care if one guy happens to live with six women that regard him as their husband? You know, it's... I understand that, at least that mindset of it. It's going to be interesting to see how that develops, though, to see if the road we take, to see if polygamy becomes straight up legalized once more. It's going to be awesome.
We'll see.
So
brave new world.
Russell, well, and like, so we're running a little bit short on time. We've got a bunch of other articles we can go through, but I'm curious, like, if we could leave those for a minute, and is there anything in your writings or stuff that you've been pondering on lately that's particularly interesting to you? Because this dialogue has actually been really, really fun for me. So I'd love it if you had any other angles or thoughts that you've been working on.
You know, I've been doing a lot of research on the expansion of the church into West Africa these days. And, you know, to, you know, tie it into the polygamy issue, you know, that was a major problem as the saints began to expand into Nigeria, especially where polygamy was considered to be legal already. You have like really committed Latter-day Saints, or at least people who want to be Latter-day Saints, and they have more than one wife. And missionaries are coming and say, well, wait a minute, he's a good, you know, he's going to be a good Mormon. He believes the Book of Mormon. He believes in Joseph Smith. He just has two wives. What are we supposed to do?
He's level 2 Mormon already.
already, right? What are we supposed to do? So you have to see, you know, you see the Mormons in America, in Salt Lake, have to do this awkward dance.
What years were this?
This was in the early 1970s.
Okay.
And, you know, earlier you talked about how, you know, as the church was looking to expand into the developing world, you know, they felt it was expedient to, you know, begin to, you know, lift the priesthood ban. But the interesting part about that is, you know, they actually dealt with these exact questions about 30 years before official declaration number 2 was released. In 1947, the Southern States Mission President Heber Meeks visited Cuba to see if Cuba, you know, would be a ripe place for preaching the gospel. But there was a problem with Cuba in the eyes of Meeks as well as several other leaders, and that is there was too much racial intermarriage. So it was hard to find a, quote, pure white race. I mean, and he used the word pure a lot, probably too much, more than we would like to hear in 2013. So he actually recommended to the first presidency that the church would expand into Cuba, just with the caveat that, you know, listen, we can't do too much with a lot of the African and, you know, Afro-Cuban populations. The first presidency decided against it, primarily, I believe, because of their distaste for interracial marriage. They just couldn't abide that.
Huh.
So, go on. What's that?
I was just going to ask, who was the prophet at that time?
At that 70s. Time, it was George Albert Smith.
Okay. He wasn't around for very long. But and tangentially, did they face a similar situation in like Dominican Republic, which is largely of old African descent? Like, how long has the church even been in somewhere like the DR or another Caribbean country?
You know, I don't know a lot about the Dominican Republic. I can say that in places like, Jamaica, the church wasn't there until after official declaration number 2.
I mean, because we have a temple in Dominican Republic, so, I mean, you know, it makes me wonder.
Right, we do.
So going back to your initial thought, though, what did they do with these good polygamist potential converts?
Right. I mean, what they ended up doing was the general authorities who were in charge. James E. Faust was one of the leading international authorities at that time.
Man, that guy's old.
Yeah, I know.
well, dead now, but he was. Yeah, he's been around for
quite a while. Initially, they actually, it was a major debate as to what they should do with it. You know, one person said, no, James E. Faust said this. No, he actually said this. So they ended up being rather inconsistent with the policies. I mean, in some cases, they did end up being able to join the church. There was a Coptic man who was able to join in the at that time. And then there were others who couldn't. So,
Wow.
Interesting. I guess as we wind down, I would love to have a quick discussion about Wear Pants to Church Day Part 2.
Ah, yes.
Did anyone wear purple? Did we wear pants as men? Did we see people wearing pants? I saw no women in pants. And I live in D.C. Nobody was in pants.
Well, I'm in Star Valley, so I'm probably not a good go-to person for representation of ordained women. I have noticed it, at least on Facebook, it's dying out somewhat. I mean, the first the first Wear Pants movement, I mean, they've got a relic in the Smithsonian Institution now.
Yeah.
Oh, they actually got that? I didn't know that it went through. How funny.
Yeah. Yeah, but now I didn't see a lot of it. So.
So do you have any thoughts? Because, well, around the pants for women sort of thing, I mean, obviously the parallel agenda around that was the ordained women. Not the same movement, obviously, but like,
sure, related.
Around that, with some of the I guess shifting mindsets and stuff, do you have any thoughts on that, I guess, ordained women movement? Do you feel like women are still oppressed in the church, and what steps need to be taken around that? Like, what are some of your thoughts on that?
You know, I feel like first of all, you know, There are two different questions wrapped up in your question. You know, first,
no,
there is.
No,
I'm sorry to inform you. No, so there's there's one question, and that is about whether women were intended to hold the priesthood in the same way that the men are.
Yeah,
that's one question. Another question, though, is how should we handle gender equality in the church? They're two separate questions. Oh,
on the first one, if I understand right, didn't women have like a lot more access to priesthood stuff in the early days?
You know, and this is where it gets interesting. You know, you can argue that Joseph Smith did indeed intend for women to hold the priesthood, and in fact that they did hold the priesthood, but not in the same way that the men did. Because, you know, if you look at records for the early church, whenever a man was ordained to a priesthood office, I mean, Mormons were meticulous. They were obsessed with record keeping. You know, they believed that the records on earth would, you know, eventually inform how things are functioning in heaven. So obviously they were very interested in records. So whenever a man was ordained, it indicated that he was an elder, a high priest, whatever. But with women, Joseph Smith was a little bit more more ambiguous. He said, "I intend for the women of the church to be a, quote, kingdom of priests," unquote. And he even approved of, you know, women administering, you know, certain ordinances. Now, were these considered priesthood ordinances? That can be debated. And did he see it as a spiritual gift, or did he see it as, you know, a priesthood ritual? So all the evidence that we have, though, indicates that he intended for women to have the priesthood through the temple endowment.
Right, which we still have today.
Which we still have today. I mean, if you were to ask me to really hang my hat on something, I would say that every woman who has received the endowment holds the priesthood. I don't think that's a controversial position. In fact, I was talking to a temple sealer at one time, and I'm not saying that this is official doctrine by any means, but I think it's an interesting point. He was doing a proxy sealing, and he decided to just give a spontaneous discourse. And he said, "So, you know, we men, we like to think that we have the priesthood. And I suppose we do, kind of. We give women, you know, we give babies blessings, and we administer sacrament, and that's all fine and good. But it's not the real thing. You know, the real thing is about carrying out the immortality and eternal life of man. Who," he asked, "is more intimately involved in that, men or women?" And he said, "Women are."
Yeah.
So, a faithful mother who has been endowed, in his eyes, held the priesthood as much, if not more so, than men. I don't know if that's, you know, how deeply that's doctrinally rooted, but I think it's a line of inquiry worth pursuing.
Well, it's one that we've heard. I mean, we've heard a lot, right? But we butcher it a lot, where we say, "You women, you have babies, and that's way more important than having."
Yeah, yeah.
Priesthood.
See, that's a fallacious argument. I'm not saying that motherhood is priesthood. I'm saying that the endowment gives a woman the priesthood in her own way. Just like being ordained an elder gives men the priesthood in their own way.
So that leads into that second part of the question, right? Where I would suggest then, if even with that sort of understanding, which I don't think any of us would disagree with, and that's a lot of the conclusion that we've come to, Jeff and I, as we've discussed as well. But then the big problem that we'd have in the church is just how we position women in the flock.
See, and
right?
That's the second question. And see, for me, it's like, if we want to talk about handling gender equality issues, okay, well, let's start with not expecting the women to make the food all the time. Right, that would be an excellent.
But we
place
suck
for,
at it. Play to your strengths. I mean, come on. Let's be honest, people.
Wait.
It's all economics at this point.
No,
right?
You're not good at barbecues. What man is not good at making barbecue? Really?
But I can't make a quinoa salad to save my life.
Okay.
So. Well, no, but you're right. You're right. Within the church, right, the Relief Society is responsible for when people are sick. They're the ones that go visit, and they're the ones that do this, and they're the ones that do that.
Yeah, and is there anything in the doctrine that says that men can't do the same thing? Why can't men go, make a pot of soup for a sick guy?
Or go visit, or help set up for a funeral, or, you know.
Yeah, there are any number of things that we can do to improve issues, you know, or overcome the issues of gender inequality in the church. And I think, frankly, we'd be more productive if we pursued that.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think sometimes it's easy to mix up the priesthood with just being able to more effectively serve in the kingdom, and that somehow, you know, having the priesthood as we assume it is related to men is directly related to that. When it's not necessarily, and it's true, I think as men we can step up a lot. It's too easy for us to instantly think that we are administrators, and, you know, we're the ones just dealing with the red tape and making things happen. We might not be the boots on the ground, like Al was saying. But, yeah, we should get out there more actively. I wish we treated I love that we do home teaching, but I love that the sisters do visiting teaching. And I wish that sometimes in our home teaching we could take a little bit of that spirit of visiting teaching with it, that we focused more on just catering to people and looking after them.
You mean doing home teaching correctly?
Doing it correctly. Yeah. But you know, to bring that care stuff, to bring somebody soup and food and this and that at the same time, not just make sure someone's spiritual needs are met, but, you know, yeah, like take care of temporal needs too. We should do it. Come on.
Right. I mean, is there anything effeminate about being a nurturing person? I mean, Jesus Christ was, you know, was the most, you know, nurturing person in our history. Right, there was no one who cared more about making sure that a person had spiritual food and physical food at times as well.
Yeah,
well played.
You brought Jesus. You brought it back to
Jesus.
I can't.
There's nothing we can say from
you, son of a bee.
Yeah, the wear pants. And going back to the pants thing, it's interesting to me because I think it's important for women's issues. My biggest beef with it is that I feel like it turns it into a distraction or. I don't know.
Well, it does because they're petitioning for something and they're demanding
not even. It becomes just more of a circus. It's like, you know, I understand that it's if you have a platform, you want to draw attention to it, and that's the way to boost your visibility.
Sure.
But I feel like, why are you coming to church? Are you coming to church because you want to worship and do your job, or are you coming to church?
Jeff, how do you fix it then? Do you have another Elders Quorum appreciation dinner where the men make a special dinner for the women?
There we go.
Nothing else we do is going to fix this stuff, right?
Well, I'm not saying we shouldn't take action. I just think the methods, perhaps, of just straight
Russell, your hand was raised.
Oh, my hand was raised. No, my primary concern with it is I know women who...
Listen,
I know women. You can cut that part out of the
ladies. I know the ladies love Russell, I can tell.
I know what women want. No, I'm just kidding. You can cut all of that out, please. No, I have some female friends who love to wear skirts. A binder full of women who they enjoy wearing skirts. They feel like they're more women that way, and I think that they shouldn't be made to feel like they're somehow backward looking if they choose to wear skirts on these Sundays, because I mean. These women happen to be some of those forward-thinking women in my social circles.
What steps do you take then? Because obviously a Relief Society dinner where we make them a dinner once a year isn't fixing anything.
No, that's patronizing. That's condescending.
If we wanted to start a movement, what does that look like? Where we were helping women, or not helping women, where we were just like helping us to not have prejudices.
I mean, the best way to break down prejudices is to get people in the same room and then talk about the elephants in the room. You know, say, hey, listen, we understand that you have some concerns. What are your concerns and how can we help you how can we fix it? Yeah. What do you want?
Do we need to quit separating during the third hour? That's just propagating this stuff.
I know.
Well, and the brethren alluded to this a bit more in the past conference. I mean, of course, there's no church policy on maligning women in ward councils and stuff like that, but it does happen because of the fallibility of man. But I noticed more remarks this conference sort of trying to remind local leadership that, hey, you have a Relief Society president for a reason. Don't just think that, you know, the buck stops there and you don't need to take the input of the sisters in your ward.
Right.
You need to utilize the sisters. And that's like what you said. I mean, get people in the room together talking. But a lot of that has to come, I think, as we grow and change and have people in leadership positions who have the correct attitude with how we're supposed to go about managing the affairs of the kingdom. It's not just a one bishop show, you know, you got to include everybody.
Right. So whatever the historical issues are in this, I mean, that doesn't change the fact that people are, I mean, and that a lot of women are feeling uncomfortable in these kinds of situations. And, you know, it doesn't mean, like I said, it doesn't matter what the documents say, you know, 150 years ago. You know, we are a living church and we can take practical, actionable measures today that still does, you know, does fair service to our traditional narrative.
All right. Will you men join me if I start a new group that is called Men for Women Serving as Sunday School President and Ward Mission Leader? That's our new platform.
All right, we demand.
I feel like we need more specific goals if these are going to come to pass. Wearing pants to church is too vague. What if our goal is explicitly, we want female ward mission leaders? There are no keys involved in that calling.
I'm against all of those sort of.
You don't want to lobby the Lord?
I demand that women pray in church, and if you love Jesus, you'll give it to us. That hurts a cause, man. It hurts.
But didn't you know?
Because then you give old Tommy Boy Monson an ultimatum, and nobody wants to do that.
It always works to give the Lord ultimatums. Look what happened to Martin Harris. It worked out great. Ultimatums.
All right, that's a good point.
Very well.
I forgot about it. Anyway, man, Russell, it has been just a delight to chit-chat and banter with you on this stuff. And I, like, I honestly, it's good to discuss some of these, the nuances of some of these different revelations and pieces of our church history. I really, man, thank you so much. One, for knowing some of this stuff and doing your research, and two, for being on the show. Now, I understand you're working on a book right now, or you've got a book that was just out, right?
I do have a book that is out. That is a black book.
Where can people go
promote
if they
yourself.
Want more Russell
definitely,
Stevenson?
Definitely. My first book is Black Mormon, The Story of Elijah Abels. You can purchase that at Benchmark Books or Eborn Books in Salt Lake, at least in hard copy format. If you are a Kindle man or woman, then please do visit Amazon.com and buy there. In fact, I probably make more money off of that, so I would specifically encourage you to go to Kindle. So that's the latest and greatest. I do have another project in the works, but when that is
finalized.
Come on,
give us a teaser. Give us a tease.
A little teaser is it does have a lot to do with the race and the priesthood statement, but okay. It's bigger than Elijah. Much bigger.
I knew it.
Long have you been doing the Mormon History Guy blog page?
You know, I began it back in 2012, but back then it was just fun and games, to be honest.
Back in 2012, you guys remember last year?
Yeah,
back when we knew Mitt Romney was going to be our leader and sovereign. Those were the days.
Yes, and I'm pretty sure Mitt Romney still owns a white horse somewhere and is in one of his many stables.
He was waiting.
But one thing I love is that you have more recently started up your own podcast. And I don't know how frequently you're going to be doing those, but I gave it
twice a month.
Twice a month. And so does each episode basically, is it just topical? You just center it
it's
on
topical,
the theme?
It's topical, yes.
Okay.
So, in future podcasts, we'll be doing things such as the history of Mormon views of grace. And that'll probably be a two-part episode. We'll be doing Mormonism and homosexuality. And for each of these episodes, we're going to generally have a guest that is relevant to the conversation today. So not just, some academic, but, for example, we just did an episode on Mormonism and dance. We had a professional dancer come. And
that seems silly.
Oh, really? let me just tell you this, my friend.
Your life work seems
silly.
It's
a fair point. I feel like Mormonism, at least on face value, Mormonism and dance seems like the episode you make when you've already done like 75 episodes and you don't know what else to do.
Well, let me tell you this.
Was Elf, Buddy the Elf, really a Mormon?
No, but put me in my place.
These are our hard-hitting
issues. I want to hear why Mormonism and dance is
relevant,
though,
genuinely. Okay, first of all, some of the highest profile celebrities in Mormonism often tend to be dancers. The Huff siblings, Chelsea Hightower.
Daryl Yeager.
Ryan Gosling.
Daryl Yeager, right. Of course, Daryl Yeager. But also, BYU's dance program is considered one of the best, if not the best, programs in the country.
Because you have a bunch of women there trying to prepare to be that perfect wife.
It's the only place
where
the dress code
comes from. Now we're talking about where it's coming from. Where does this, what enables Mormons to be, so interested in dance? I mean, does it have to do with her sexuality? Does it have to do with race in some degree? I mean, Latin dance is big at BYU. I mean,
how else can you accentuate your bosoms if at BYU if you don't have that ballroom gown?
I like how you're reducing this to such simple factors.
That's what Al does.
I appreciate that.
Al is a simplifier. He's a distiller. That's
it's all about objectification.
Russell, I
don't know why I'm not married, guys. I can't figure it out.
Russell, would you please follow that up, though, with an episode called, like, Mormons and Lilith Fair? So we can explore that side.
Oh,
of the
Lilith?
Sexuality,
yes.
Equation.
Yes. Lilith definitely needs to make. We'll be doing one on Mormon views of Adam and Eve. So that'll be
I like
them.
If you ever do one on like Mormons and dumb people, Al and I would be happy to show up.
Mormons
just something
and dumb
along just
I'm sure we can arrange for
not
that.
Us. We know a guy.
Though if you do do like Mormons and tech startups or anything like that, Al actually is your guy. So bear that one in
mind. I'm quite savvy with nerdery.
That's how we take Mormons and then just like we pull a slip of paper out of the hat.
Mormons. I also look forward to Mormons
chewing
and
gum.
Mormons and cuisine. That could be a fun one.
Oh,
Mormons
oh,
and quiches.
Guys.
All right, well, I'm convinced that we love sugar so much because it is a substitute for alcohol.
Mormons and sugar. No, it's true.
Right.
And that's why I love sleep so much because I can't get drunk. So,
next best thing, just nap. We'll just wake up.
Anyway, folks, make sure to go to is it Mormon History Guy? Is it .blogspot.com or is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
so,
it's just MormonHistoryGuy.com.
Okay, go to MormonHistoryGuy.com. Check out the blog and his podcast. Russell's all over the place. He's he's winning. He's proven that he's a more interesting person than Al and I combined times five.
Oh, please,
so
please.
But if, on the flip side, you end up still wanting to interact with us and not Russell, send us an email at contact at thisweekinmormons.
Yes, please do.
Or go to thisweekinmormons.com and leave a comment on this week's episode. We'd love to hear from you.
Or go to facebook.com/thisweekinmormons. Find us at The Real Twim on Twitter. Find us on Pinterest. Get on our YouTube page.
Don't bother on Pinterest.
Nope,
who are we
I'm trying.
Pinterest, come on. Come
I'm
on,
trying.
Man.
I'm trying.
We have boards of wedding shoes and tuxedo bow ties.
And also, I love to do my final plug, of course. Subscribe to Sunday School Bonanza, our other podcast where we go over gospel doctrine lessons in about 15 minutes.
Fantastic.
And sign up for our gospel study sesh email list where we go over just gospel topics to actually improve.
We are on forgiveness right now. Forgiveness.
Yes, Alan. You were supposed to send out an email today. But you.
Oh, I scheduled it for tomorrow on accident.
That's okay. We'll make it happen.
Really. I
anyways, we got to run. Russell, once again, thank you very much for joining us.
Been my pleasure. I endorse this message.
All right.
All right.
We'll see
this
everybody.
Has been This Week in take Mormons. Care. Al, you take care too. And everybody, be well, be merry, be bright, and Merry Christmas. We'll talk to you later. This Week in Mormons is out. Shut up. All right. I'm gonna find you, ready for silence and the heat. What have you got? Limited value on my stuff. Falling and rising, I'm gonna cut loose. Love is an unfamiliar name. What have you got? Love is an unfamiliar name. I keep on trying to reach you, but you're never the same. I'm ready for silence.